From the earliest times onwards, from Paul onwards, from the scriptures onwards, one God the Father, one Lord Jesus Christ, one made known through one Holy Spirit, one Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God. By the time we get to the 4th century, this will be affirmed in language of nature and persons. There is one nature, three persons. Okay? So the Son is what the Father is, but a different person. Okay? We have to be really careful with the term person, however, because for us, it has got all sorts of other content. We think we know what it is to be persons, because of course we're persons, you know, we know what it's like to be a person. But even the shape of human personhood has dramatically changed over the centuries. You know, the study of history will teach that. The invention of the inner self with the time of Augustine, that kind of thing, the discovery of the unconscious, with Freud in the late 19th, early 20th century, all those kind of things give rise to what we think of as what we know by person. We should be really hesitant to project that onto God. Now, emphatically, the Christian revelation is that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, which means he is what it is to be God, but he's other than the one he calls Father, and that we know this in and through the Holy Spirit. So we could talk about the Father, the Son, and the Spirit being persons.
Were those from everlasting? They were all contemporaneous forever?
There's no temporality when we're talking
no
about
temporality,
God. No temporality is in a really long time, but it's atemporal.
If they have atemporal existence, how is it determined that one is the Father and one is the Son? It seems like that's a hierarchical relationship, right?
Yeah, but it's a hierarchy of cause rather than temporal.
Hierarchy of cause? So how do you have cause in atemporality?
For instance, does the sun precede the light that emanates from it?
I think the answer is yes.
No, there's no sun without light. At least within a 4th century way of thinking, there'd be no temporal distinction between that. A fountain and a river. A fountain and the water coming out from it. They're logically cause and effect. Temporally, they're simultaneous. You don't have one without the other. You don't have a father without a son. You don't have a son without a father.
Right.
But there's a priority.
How did they determine who would be who?
I don't think the discussion even developed like that. The discussion is really about this person, Christ, and what he tells us about God, what he shows us about God. It's not a discussion about how should we create a trinity. Let's set about discussing one, inventing one.
I appreciate the tenets of the church. What I'm trying to do is for someone who is not part of that, try to approach it in a way that seems logical rather than having a kind of an internal circular reasoning.
You have to go back to Christ. Logic starts with him, not with a discussion about the Trinity. The logic starts with him and the affirmation that this is what it is to be God.
What are the characteristics of the divine centers of activity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit? What is it about their
the
inner being that we can discern in terms of their mental life, if I use that term?
In a sense, all of those would be human projections.
Sure,
you know,
sure.
Because we're talking about ourselves as a person and projecting and wanting to see that in God. I honestly don't think one can do that at all. The figures who were developing Trinitarian theology in that way would say that it's not comparable to three human beings getting together. Yeah?
Okay.
It's not the Father does something, the Son does something else, the Spirit does something else.
Okay.
There's only one work which they do. If they were each doing separate things, then you'd be able to look at them distinctly. I can see the Father over here, I can see Christ here, I can see the Spirit here.
Well, theoretically, we had that when Jesus was a human being,
but
right?
But the only thing we can say about that this is the image of the invisible God. We don't look for God somewhere else. He shows us what it is to be God. There's no kind of surplus of divinity that I can see. Christ is doing something on earth, but the Father's doing something on Mars. No, it's not like that. Christ is the fullness of divinity incarnate. There's no surplus left anywhere else. This is it. This is what it is to be God.